Hello, I'm Keren Coney, and my talk is entitled What Should Be Done to Ensure Autistic Graduates Succeed in the Workplace? And just to tell you more of who I am, I'm a Careers and Employability Consultant at Liverpool John Moores University in the UK. I'm also a part-time PhD student at the Autism Centre for Education and Research at the University of Birmingham, also in the UK. So just to outline what I'd like to cover during this talk, first of all, I'd like to provide some brief context for the topic. I'd also like to outline the methodology I've used for the study I'm going to describe. Before going on to my findings, first of all, around the key areas of challenge for autistic graduates, and secondly, around effective strategies employed by autistic individuals. And finally, I'd like to go on to recommendations. First of all, university-based ones, and secondly, work-based recommendations. So first of all, thinking about the context. Now, this first statistic is a UK-based one. However, we know that internationally, there are increasing numbers of autistic students year on year in institutions around the world. Secondly, we also know full well that autistic graduates frequently have disappointing employment outcomes. And again, this is represented in the literature. Employment is key for the well-being of individuals, as noted here. And it is worth bearing in mind that there are a range of activities that have been developed to seek to support success rates for autistic individuals. These include supported work placement programs and mentoring schemes too. However, what is of note is that these aren't found in every university, in every place around the world. There's an uneven distribution at present. It's worth also noticing that there's a kind of lack of the perspectives of autistic people in research in this area, and that's something that should be addressed too. So moving on to the methodology. So as mentioned, I'm a PhD student, and my topic is exploring what can be done to support autistic students to successfully progress to employment after graduation. I'm looking particularly at what careers practitioners like myself can do in this area. So for that reason, I'm using an action research approach. Now, this is something that particularly appealed because it's about looking at your own practice as a practitioner, thinking about how it can be improved. And it also has a cyclical approach. So as is shown in this diagram here, so you might try something out, you would observe and collect data, then you would reflect on how that went, what was learned, and then using those reflections, you would plan the next cycle, seeking to improve it in some way. So that's what I'm doing over a number of years with my PhD. The final element that I wanted to mention is that actually I'm using a participatory action research approach. So this involves involving autistic students and graduates at each stage of the process. And what I'm going to describe today is actually cycle one. So this is before I even start, I want to gain understanding of the experiences, the lived experiences of autistic graduates. So what I did is I got 11 participants who had all graduated within the last 5 years, all with autism. And they had varying employment status when I interviewed them. So some were employed full time, some in part time jobs, some self-employed and some unemployed. And they'd all come from varying universities as well, some new, some older, all within the UK. So as mentioned, I conducted a series of interviews, and then I transcribed the recordings and analysed the data using Braun and Clark's six-phase approach, which involved sort of coding the data, finding initial themes, going back over the data, kind of confirming those themes, and then defining them fully. And as a result, I have two key themes, and these each have 5 sub-themes, and I'll go on to describe them now. So first of all, the first theme, as mentioned in the right at the beginning, is it was about key areas of challenge. Now, the first one will come as no surprise, unfortunately, that job interviews were mentioned repeatedly as an area of challenge. Now, one of the autistic graduates said, "I struggled with interviews, not only being able to read body cues, struggling with my tone of voice, and quite an intense anxiety, which made me stumble in the flow of my answers." A second sub-theme was around employer responses to disclosure. So where the participants, some of them had disclosed that they'd actually not received the response they were expecting. I'd like to mention here, I've mentioned the word disclosure a couple of times now, and there are some within the disability community who prefer not to use that word because it has negative connotations, and I agree with those. And the reason for me using it now is because that was the term used by the participants in the study, it was one that they chose to use themselves, and this is shown here. The most frustrating thing was that despite disclosing my autism, I felt the employers were not making slight adjustments to make my experience of interviewing easier. A third area of challenge was around relational issues and isolation in the workplace. So some really struggled with challenges of the social side of things in work. So one said, I struggle with getting to know people deeper and forming those sort of relationships and friendships. I think that's why I seek fixed term contracts, because the idea of a 9-to-5 forever, it's very daunting. So it's really hard to hear that this is actually the social challenges were to such an extent that it was having an impact on the type of work and the security of the work contracts that he was going for. A fourth area was related to otherness. And this is where the participants described the sort of the mystery of the workplace and how it was just something that was quite foreign to them. And in addition, they also mentioned that sometimes they were misunderstood by employers and colleagues too. So this is kind of reflecting the double empathy problem that's been described by Milton, where it's just that there's misunderstanding or a lack of understanding on both sides. So one autistic graduate said, I would still regard the working world, its day structure, worker interrelationships and working mindsets to be all a very foreign world to me. And finally, in the areas of challenge, some of this of being misunderstood and then not being clear and the mystery of the workplace led to self-doubt for some autistic graduates. And one said, basically getting overwhelmed, crying in the toilets. This is the wrong job. This is the wrong environment. So I'm wrong. And I'll go into depression and I'm broken. This is so hard to hear that just this misunderstanding and being misunderstood could lead to mental health issues here and just strong feelings, negative feelings in the workplace. So moving on to the second theme, which was around effective strategies employed by individuals. So again, there are five sub-themes. One of them is around self-awareness. So this was found, it was great to see that many of the participants, they were able to describe their skills and their strengths in a really articulate way, and also to talk about how they had developed those over time in the workplace. And in addition, they were able to talk about their preferences for work. So one of them said, I need stimulation and the opportunity to do something that I feel at least vaguely matters and is interesting. And this was particularly of note because this participant had actually been told that he was eligible for full-time benefits. He didn't need to work according to his health issues. And his family were kind of encouraging him to not work. But he knew that actually he needed that work and he wanted that stimulation, as he's put here. And he was really enjoying his job, so which was great to see. A second sub-theme was around navigating unpredictability. Now, some of the participants described situations where they'd shown their optimism and being sort of flexible, curious, and even sort of risk-taking about the type of work they were looking at and going for. And these are all characteristics of a career model called planned happenstance, which basically says that if the world is unpredictable, so what we need to do if we are to navigate our careers successfully is to adopt certain characteristics, including those I've just described, curiosity and risk-taking. And it was great to see that this was being done successfully by some of the participants. One of them said, And this person had actually, they were having an unsuccessful time. It was their first year away at university, and they were really miserable. They ended up, transferring to a different university. But this is what they said about that year. Luckily, I had the attitude where I sort of thought, well, what can I do whilst I'm there? So building up the business and getting a website set up were just the loveliest distraction from everything else. Another sub-theme was around the importance of networking. So several participants described how their connections had helped them. One mentioned about how it helped them to get an internship. And another participant said that before an interview with the civil service, they decided to find the contact details of a senior person in the recruitment team or department of that part of the civil service, and had contacted them and asked them, okay, what should I expect in the interview? And they'd been given some helpful information. So that participant said, just asking the right questions to the right people and you get the right answers, don't you? A fourth area was around work experience and how this was really important as well. So one participant said, by the time I started my master's degree, I knew I wasn't going down the corporate law route. As it happened, it was also around this time that I started getting more involved with X, which was a particular charity. And ultimately, that was what finally set my mind on the charity sector. So here we're seeing how work experience is helping to determine inform career decision making. It was also notable that many of the participants who were enjoying work and in employment when I interviewed them had actually gained work experience while still at university. And the final sub-theme here was around identifying and overcoming challenges. So this seemed to be a key theme in that a number of the participants were able to articulate some of the areas that were difficult for them and then how they put strategies in place to help them overcome them. So one example was a participant who got very anxious and knew what helped and hindered his mental health. And he said, my day is very structured, which means it's very stress-free. I don't have to think about work when I get home. Not having to think about work keeps my anxiety down. So there were the findings. So moving on to the final section, which is about recommendations. First of all, university-based recommendations. I've got three here that I'd like to describe to you. First of all, it's around enhanced one-to-one support. So given all that's been said about sort of what can make and help an autistic graduate to be successful, it's really important to think about how that could be sort of developed whilst they're still at university. Now, in universities, one-to-one support is generally available, but much of the time, this is around supporting people to be successful in their studies. Now, that's really important, but sometimes I think what is missed out is their support for planning and preparing for what happens after university as well. So if this was put in place, and obviously this does happen to a certain extent, particularly with career services, the one-to-one support, I think, should particularly focus on developing that self-awareness. It's going to help people to know what they're good at, know what they might want and need in the workplace, and also the planned happenstance characteristics that I mentioned. Secondly, heard some really important and helpful stories about identifying challenges and developing strategies to overcome them. So starting to help students to prepare for work by, in this area would also be helpful. And finally, one thing that is often lacking actually is thinking about how to ensure that students, autistic students, are informed about the support that's available after they leave university. So this could be support from a university, say from their career service, but it could also be other organisations. There are charities, and even it could be funding from governments that can help as they're seeking work and to help them succeed in the workplace as well. A second university-based recommendation that I'd like to make is around increasing the opportunities for work experience, but also networking. So I mentioned how important these two areas had been for the autistic graduates that were involved in my study. The first of all, thinking about work experience, there are some tailored schemes, but not at all universities. And it shouldn't be the case that an autistic student misses out just because their university doesn't offer a scheme like this. And secondly, many, if not all universities that I'm aware of, do have sort of opportunities for networking in some way. This might be a careers fair or an alumni event. But as sometimes I think more thought needs to be put into ensuring that they are accessible for autistic students. So this could mean ensuring that there is a quiet hour or something as part of the careers fair, or it could be about ensuring that they are prepared and know what to expect about an alumni event, but making sure that those events and those important opportunities are as accessible as possible is important. And finally, the two recommendations I've just mentioned, they involve several different university departments in most cases. So one thing that I'm suggesting as a third recommendation is around collaboration with these different departments. So it could be that career service are involved, plus disability support could be providing some of these supports. It also could be the alumni team or department, and perhaps even other student support services. So it's really important that they work together to communicate with each other about what is happening, what they are offering, so that they can inform students that they happen to be meeting with. And even more importantly, I think, is an effective referral system, which means that if one part of the university is offering that support, they can help to refer that student to where else they might need. So, for example, if a disability service happened to be working with someone and that person was particularly anxious about what was going to happen after university, that there would be a referral system in place to the career service so that that student could then access that support more easily. So it's about removing barriers and making sure it's as streamlined as possible. And finally, work-based recommendations. And again, I have three to suggest here. The first one is about autism awareness training for employers. So some of the challenges that were outlined by the autistic graduates in my study were around judgment and discrimination and just not getting the what they expected once they shared information about their autism with an employer. So it's I find that many employers actually, they want to be supportive and provide an inclusive environment, but perhaps they don't know how or what's involved. There's often misunderstanding there. So autism awareness is really key, and there should be more of that. Now, one thing I wanted to mention was reverse mentoring. And this is quite a new concept, certainly to me, but it's happening in the UK with various types of disability. Quite recently, that's been brought about. But the idea is that in the case that I'm talking about, you would have autistic mentors, so individuals who are autistic, who act as mentors to senior management in an organization, or perhaps to recruitment teams in an organization. And they share information about, well, what sort of other barriers or challenges might be, and how they could alleviate those, how they could make their workplaces and their recruitment processes more accessible. And there's been some real success in this area. So I think that more should be done to explore reverse mentoring as a tool to raise awareness in the workplace. Secondly, there's a lot of talk around how challenging interviews are for autistic individuals. And I think they're really, it's time to do more exploration of what can be done as an alternative. There are other ways that employers can assess the suitability of candidates for a role. And one way that is starting to be used, so for example, EY have internationally been introducing neurodiverse centres of excellence. And as part of this, they are, instead of having an interview, their recruitment process involves a super week where the candidates that have been shortlisted are invited along, they work on projects, they work with each other, they're observed, and that is how the selection takes place. So thinking about that type of thing should happen. This is an example of good practice, but more research is required to see, well, what works, and compelling evidence could then be shown to employers to help them with this. And finally, that mentoring in the workplace would be really helpful. So for those autistic individuals who are successful in in the recruitment process can then be successful in maintaining their work and thriving in the workplace. Now, one thing that's quite interesting that one of the participants mentioned was this idea of a soft landing. Now, soft landing is actually a term from the construction sector, and it's the idea that builders who are building a building, when they've completed that building, they don't just leave, they actually inform the users of the building how to get the most out of that building. So it's the idea that that there's support in place. And that participant that mentioned this, he was saying it would be so good if there could be a soft landing for autistic graduates in the workplace. And mentoring would be a really good way to do that, so that individuals could be shown how to get the most out of their role, what's expected, and just given that support to thrive in the workplace. So just to summarize everything that I've just said, really there's much that can and should be done to support autistic graduates to be successful in the workplace. And I think in all cases, those responsible for bringing change about should remember that they need the expertise of autistic organisations and autistic individuals themselves when bringing about that change, to make sure it's as effective as possible. And in addition, given the economic case for increasing employment rates for autistic individuals, I think it's really important that calls are made to our governments to suggest that more support, more resources are offered to universities and to employers to ensure that they are making their places, their organisations, as inclusive as possible for autistic individuals, and that you know, that they're being prepared for the workplace and to be successful there. And I think also that our governments should then hold these organizations accountable for providing these environments. And if this was done, then there would it would just allow for the thriving and success of autistic individuals in the workplace. Thanks very much for listening.